啊。This plus this equal to this. This plus this equal to this. This plus this equal to this. Is this how your primary school teacher teach you about fraction? Huh? So I have finished about half, already about 13 or 14 people give me this kind of solution. I don't know, I thought I had thought of a very simple problem for y'all so that y'all do, you can score during midterm test. Adding two fractions together, multiplying two fractions, all those things, and then I get this kind of solution. I'm really worried. Not because you do not know Java, but because you do not know do simple mathematics. Ah. And then another 10 to 20% of the students do not know that, or did not know that, when you call a, when you write a class, okay, when you have a method inside there saying that I want to add a fraction to another fraction, a lot of people say, where is the other fraction? How come there's only one parameter only? Where is the other fraction? Where is the other fraction? If that method is an instant method, what do you mean by instant method? There must be an object to call this method, right? So therefore, that object is a fraction itself, and then you pass in another fraction for them to sum together, to multiply, right? This is a basic Java. So I really have a shock when I was marking. I don't know, what went wrong? We didn't say this clearly enough. And then how do you do your second CE lab? Object-oriented, what? Okay, so we really need to do, I don't know, what kind of remedial we can do to overcome this problem. Any suggestion? Okay, you all can suggest. How do we improve? Of course, I can conduct remedial lesson for fraction operation. How to add these two numbers together? That one we can, maybe 10 minutes we can do it. But what about Java? How much time we need to actually overcome that, those kind of problems? I'm really worried. We will see. Okay, at the end, how is the midterm goes at the end? I don't know. Okay, we will see. Anyway, today we are going to start a new topic, creating two more ADT. Okay, writing two more ADT, and you can see that this is how programming is done. We build new ADT based on what we have learned before, using what we learned before as what we call underlying data structures. Okay, meaning that now this ADT is using the previous ADT as underlying data structures. Okay, then we build on top of it. Right, and then we say that these are two basic ADT, and what happened to the, they are again linear data structures, linear, one after the other. And most of the time when we say they are linear, we can consider them to be a list of items. Okay, settle down. So the objective of this lecture is to define stack ADT, and then after that, QADT, and then we look at how we can implement these two new ADT using either array or linked list. Okay, and then of course we talk about the benefit of using each one of them. And then we want to look at how stack and queue can be used in some application, and they have some important application. And of course, in Java, they provide us with this stack ADT or stack class and a queue interface. Okay, so you see the two. In Java API, there's a stack class, but there's only a queue interface, so there's no queue class. So you are supposed to use a linked list inside the Java API and make it to become like a queue. So you can only use certain method inside there rather than using some of the other method. Otherwise, we say that you actually violate the ADT principle, okay? Because you try to go into the middle of the queue, which you are not allowed, okay? And then if you want to look at your textbook, these are the two chapters. So we are going to go through all these things, okay? Most likely we can finish all this today, 2 hours. So stack, I'm sure you use this or you have deal with this every day, okay? I don't know, in your study table, you might have a stack of notes. Okay, so you every time a new lecture comes in, you print it out and then you put on top. Okay, and put on top. Eventually, after a while, you don't know what is at the bottom of the stack, right? So you go to canteen, you will see a stack of bowl, stack of plate or whatever. So you take the first one. Anyone go there and say, oh, the first one is very dirty. I want to take the last one. So you take the whole pile away and then take the last one. You will never do that. Yeah. So you take from the top. The cleaner will also, when they wash the plate or whatever the tray, they put on top. Okay. So those are stacked. So stack sometimes is also called a last in, first out data structures. The last item that you put into the data structures is the first one that you remove. Okay. You will never remove the first one first. Yeah. Last one to go in, the first one to remove. So this is what we call last in, first out. And we said that a stack of collection, a stack is a collection of data that is accessed in the last in, first out manner. And basically this ADT has only three major operations besides those common method that we have in all the classes, right? It's empty and all those kind of things. Yeah. So in this case for a stack, we have a push, we have a pop, and we have a pip. Okay, push is to add one element to the stack. Pop is to remove one element from the stack. Pip is to look at the top of the element to make decision. You have to know what do you want to do. If the top item is equal to this, whether you want to push a new item on top or you should remove the first item. Okay, you have to look at the first element. Right, so like for example, I want to push this item, so you push it on top. If I want to remove, you pop it. Okay, so these are the two terms that we use. When you talk about stack, pop, and push, right, pip is to look at the first element. Sometimes people say top, if you like, it's okay. Right, so pip is to look at the first element. Right, so these are some of the usage, but of course, definitely there are many more other usage. And in fact, subsequently, you're going to realize that stack is very useful to improve the algorithm that you are having, okay, the efficiency of the algorithm that you are having. So I will show you one example at the end of this part of the lecture, how you can actually improve an algorithm, maybe from O n cube, which is very slow, okay, to actually O n. Just by using a stack, you can actually improve so much. So it's very useful, okay, a stack. Right, so we said that a stack can be used internally by the machine when you call a function. When you make a function call, a method call, the system need to suspend the execution of this current part of the program and then send the control into the method, right? So this one had to be stored somewhere because when you are calling this method, the method can call another method, right? So therefore, every time you call a method, you have to suspend the current execution. And this is actually put on top of the stack. So that when that method call is completed, you will have to come back. Where do you go back to? You pop on the stack and then, hello? No more battery.
Hello?
Can you hear?
Right, so you have to go back and then, you have to restore the previous copy of the. It's my voice, not the microphone. Yeah? Sorry, technology.
Okay, so we were saying that whenever you make recursive call, okay, or method call, so we are saying that, first of all, you are supposed to put this thing onto a stack, right? And then if this guy, After I put this on the stack, and then you pass control into another call, right? And this guy is going to make another method call. So therefore, you have to put this guy on the stack also. And then you make this call. And when this is completed, you have to go back to here. But where do you find it? It's very easy because you just pop this guy and then restore it. When you say restore, means you have to put back all the local value, okay, all the local variable, put back all the value so that you can continue executing the rest of the statement. And then when this is done, again, you pop this, put it back, and then continue executing the rest. So this is what a stack is about. So I was telling some students yesterday about the usage of stack. Whenever they give you a problem and say that you are not supposed to use any additional data structures and you are supposed to solve that problem, one of the things that you come to your mind should be recursive call. Because when you do recursive call, there's an internal stack that you use. You do not need to create your own stack. There's an internal stack which function like what we say just now. Okay, so you can actually do that. So this is what you say down here. A stack is used by the system when you make recursive function call. Right? You put on top of the stack, and if you have a recursive call, you will just on top of the other one. So a recursion is what we say. The other one is matching paradigms. Okay, for example, you have some very complex formula and involve a lot of paradigms. Like for example, I have something like this, and then maybe, you know, the curly bracket and so on. So you have to check whether this formula is well formed, in the sense that the bracket and the square bracket and all those kind of things are matched. Okay, the number of opening brackets match with the number of closing brackets, and at the same time the type must be the same. Okay, so in this case it's very easy to do this by using a stack. Okay, later we will see the example. Right, then if you want to evaluate expression, okay, all the calculator, all the computer that we use, when you try to key in some expression and then get the computer to say, okay, A plus B minus C and whatever, equal to what? They have to do this, okay? Most of them convert it to become something called a postfix expression, or sometimes they call it reverse Porries notation. Reverse notation. It is actually saying that our operator is actually at the back of the two operand, okay? So in this case, we want to know how to do postfix calculation, and at the same time, we want to know how to convert infixed expression, like for example, this guy, to become postfix expression. Right. So in this case, this guy is going to become A plus, and then C minus. So this is infix, and this is postfix. So we want to learn how to convert an infix expression into a postfix expression, okay, using a stack. And then another example is traversing a maze. So the idea is that when you go into the maze, you know, when you come to a junction, there are two or three possible directions that you can go. How do you decide? Okay, how do you come back to the junction? If you select this path and this path lead you to a dead end, you want to go back. So the idea is you can actually store this junction into a stack so that when you reach a dead end, you just pop. It's like teleporting. Okay, the computer will bring you to the junction and you can choose another one. So traversing a maze, you can use a stack to help you to do it. And of course, as I say, a stack can be used for many other purposes. I will show you another one at the end of the discussion. Right, so again, when you want to specify ADT, to tell people what this class or this ADT is having inside there, how do you use the ADT, the method inside there? You use an interface to specify. Okay, interface is for specification. Right, so this is a stack ADT and it's generic, okay? Right, the common or the most important operation that you want to perform using a stack is this four, okay? First of all, you have to check whether a stack is empty, okay? The algorithm always go this way. If the stack is empty, you push. You don't need to think about anything, okay? So you first of all need to know whether the stack is empty. And as I said just now, you need to know what is on top. What is the value on top? Because this one helps you to make decision whether you want to push or you want to pop, yeah? And then, of course, if you are supposed to pop, you just pop it away. And if you are supposed to push, you push, okay? And these two has what you call underflow condition. If you want to but there's nothing inside there. You have to say that it is an empty stack, nothing inside. If you want to pop, you have to say there's nothing inside there for you to pop. You throw this exception. Push, it depends on what data structures you use. Okay, later we will see. Right, so for example, let's say I have already created a stack, so the stack ADT, I create this new stack. So in this case, I'm just using a stack, a general stack, not a generic one. So I can just imagine that I'm pushing a string inside that, okay? Right, so create an empty stack will give you this, the meaning that the effect of this statement is like that. Okay, you have a stack which is empty. And then you say, I want to push. So A's go inside there. I push again. B goes inside. And then I push again, C on top. I want to look at what is inside the, at the top of the stack. You return the value. Okay, then you store it into a temporary variable. You say pop. So the top is pop away. Push. And then you pop again. Okay, so simple. Stack is very simple. It's just this operation. But of course, when you use a stack to solve problem, the algorithm come into play. How do you, write all this push and pop in certain sequence such that the problem that you are having can be solved? Okay. Right. So the idea is that we are talking about A, B, C, which are strings. So actually, inside the stack is not really A, B, C. What do you think should be inside that? What are inside? When you say push a string, what do you push inside? The reference, okay, the address of all these objects, okay? You are not pushing the character inside that. I mean the string inside that. The other question is, can we replace the A with the character A? Can we replace this with this? No, they are of different type, okay? A string is a string. If you try to put a character inside there, it's not possible, yeah? Right. So we want to see how we can implement a stack using array, right? So we say use an array with a top index pointer to actually implement an array, implement a stack. So in this case, we say that the underlying data structure of this stack is actually an array, right? So this thing is called the underlying data structure. Okay, so that is a name that we give to whatever you use to implement the new ADT. So very simple, inside there you have an array which actually can be used to store the elements that you want to put inside there. And then of course you have the size, the maximum size. So in this case it's 0 to 9 because the maximum size is equal to 10. Right, then you just simply use this pointer, an index, to indicate where is the top of the stack. Okay? Right, so if you push, to push something inside there, you just increment the pointer, the index by one, and then just put the value inside there. Okay, push again. Okay, put it there, right? And then to pop, you just move the pointer back, the index back. So the idea is whether you need to make this to become a null value or not, the answer is no, okay? Because we are using this index to say that this is the top. Even though you put something over there, when you pop, you do not need to physically erase it, because the pointer will indicate that you have only so many items inside there, okay? Right, so the implementation. So stack using array implements the ADT, okay? So we have this array to create for this type of value, and then the top is to be the index for you to point to the top elements, maximum size. And then the initial size is actually equal to 1,000. Right, so you have to have, when you create a class, you must have the constructor. So this is a constructor. And you have to initialize an empty array. Okay, at the moment, maybe you do not need to worry why we have to do this. Okay, it is because internally when Java create an array of generic type, they have to ensure that the type are type safe, you know, meaning that you can only put this thing inside there. If you don't declare it this way, you might get some warning message, okay? So you just say that we have to do this. And top is equal to minus one. Remember, we said that top is actually pointing to the first element. So when you initialize an empty stack, your top must be pointing outside to indicate that this is actually an empty stack, yeah? and the maximum size is equal to the initial size. So you can change this if you feel that this is too wasteful. I don't think I have 1,000 elements. At most, I have maybe 140, the class of D. You can change this to 140 if you like. Okay, but of course, if you say, if you put the number too small, later you're going to see that it is an expensive exercise to extend the stack in order to continue the operation. So this is up to you. You have to estimate, yeah, as a programmer. Right, then your is empty. Return the Boolean value. You just check whether the top is less than zero. We say already, minus one means the stack is empty. Okay, and you have the pip. Pip simply look at the first item, and if it is an array, you just use the index to return the item. Yeah, so array.top, index top will give you the first item. And then as we say already, if the stack is empty, you have to say that it is an empty stack. Just throw this exception, okay? Pop is to pop some element, the top element, and normally when you pop, you return that value to indicate what value you pop it up. So therefore, you actually save this guy inside here. And you can see that in this case, you are using pip, okay? Because pip actually returns that value. So you call pip to return that value. And then, because we say already, pop means you just move the index by one to the left, yeah? And then you return the object. And you can see that in this case, you don't need to have the size attribute inside that. You do not need to say, oh, now I have five elements inside that, because the top actually telling you how many elements you have inside, yeah? Believe or not? If I have five elements, where is the top pointing to? Yeah, so just you use 4 plus 1 will give you the size of the thing, yeah? Right, so when you push, you want to push some element inside there, because it's an array, you have to check whether you still have enough space for you to, one more space to put you, to put in one more element, right? So if the top is already greater than maximum size minus one or equal, that means you have already putting using the last element inside the array. You have no choice. In order to continue this operation, you have to call this method called enlarge the array, which is actually down here. Okay, so how do you do enlarge? If the stack is full, of course this is an array, you can look at it this way. Yeah, the top is down here, so in this case the top. What do you do? You have to actually double the size. Normally, when you do the increment and larger thing, you double the size, yeah? And what you have to do is you copy this like that. And then after that, previously this pointer was pointing here. Now you use this pointer to point to the new array, and then you can continue, okay? Because now the top will be pointing to here. You can put in additional element. Right, so this is an expensive exercise. As I say, you have to actually create a new array, double the size, you have to do the copying one by one. There's no copy the whole array into another array. There's no such thing. Yeah? So in this case, the new size is equal to 2 times the maximum size. And you create the new array using the same way of creation. And then this is to copy. The for loop just copy everything from the old array into the new array. And finally, you assign that array pointer to the new array so that you come back here, you can just use the same pointer to look at the value, okay? So to push, because it's an array, you have to worry about this. When the array is full, you have to create, you have to extend or enlarge. Right, so we see straight away that the array might not be a good way of you implementing a stack, okay? Unless you really know how much elements you are going to put onto the stack. Otherwise, don't use an array. Yeah, because the size is fixed, you always have this problem. Right, so therefore, definitely then people think about using the linked list. Oh, okay, so people might ask, can I use vector? Can I use array list? Answer is of course yes, okay? Those Java will have to do it for you, okay? So the idea is, then you might ask, then why should I consider using the linked list? Internally, Java still need to do the enlarge for you. So you declare that the capacity is this. Once you are over the capacity, Java also need to extend the thing for you. So they are actually copying the thing for you. It's not that they can increase the array by itself. Array list vector, the underlying data structures are still array. You still suffer from the same problem, right? So they still have to do it. So therefore, for efficiency consideration, linked list is a better idea. Okay, and in fact, Linked list is actually quite easy to implement a stack, right? Right, so the other thing we want to make notes is when you want to create a new ADT using existing data structures or ADT, there are two ways of doing it, two ways to do it. One is what we call composition. Composition is like you write composition, you write something, you create something new, okay? Right, do something new using whatever you have before. Or you can do inheritance, okay, in terms of programming in Java. So composition is actually creating an object of the underlying data structures, and then use this object to call those methods inside the underlying data structures. Understand this? I have, like for example, in this case, basic linked list. Basic linked list can be used to push and pop, because you add front will give you push. If you remove, add first or remove first, you are going to get the push and pop. Yeah. So therefore, composition means I declare my new class, and inside there, I actually create an object of the old class. Okay. Inheritance means I create a subclass. The new stack ADT is actually a subclass of, like for example, basic linked list. So if it is a subclass, I can use all the methods inside the superclass. I just need to use them. I do not need to define it myself. Okay. So there are two ways of creating new classes using existing class. Right, so by composition, we use basic linked list. As we say, I think 2 weeks ago or at the beginning of, before the midterm break, basic linked list can be used to implement a stack, okay? Because basically the push is actually at front or at first. The pop is just remove first, okay? Right, so we do composition means by looking at some picture to show you, this is a basic linked list, which is underlying data structures. We just enclose it into a new class, encapsulation. Yeah, we could enclose it to become like that. So we are actually creating a linked list, which is actually a basic linked list, and then we call this a stack. Okay, we just create an object and then call this a stack. So this is stack implementing using linked list, LL. Just now it's ARR, yeah? Right, so in this case, you need to have this number of nodes because now we don't have this index to tell us where is this index, how many elements are there. So we have to create this. And we know that in basic linked list, we have this attribute inside that. And of course, basic linked list also have a head pointer pointing to the front. Okay? Right, and the front is actually top of the list. So you are not going to add over here. You are going to add here and remove here. Okay? Right, so therefore now this is actually a stack ADT or new class, LL, implementing the stack ADT, okay? This is actually the, what you call, interface. And because it's by composition, you need to create a basic linked list because we are using basic linked list object to actually perform the method, the operation for us. So I create a new basic linked list and call this a list, yeah? To check whether the stack is empty, there is an empty method inside the basic linked list, right? So since we have it, we just use the object to call the method. Okay, use the object list that we have created for basic linked list to call the method inside there, and it will just return true or false. Right, to look at the first element inside the stack, we know that there is a get first method inside the basic linked list class. So you just simply call that get first method inside the object, and then it will return you that value. So again, you have to check for empty list, right? So this actually, first of all, when you say get first, basic linked list throw you this element, no such element. And then you yourself, inside this stack ADT, throw this empty stack exception, okay? Because basic linked list, the message that they throw is no such element. You try to get something there, but the list is empty. So you throw this no such element, but this is not meaningful to a stack ADT. So you have to say it is an empty stack so that the user will know, okay? Right, then you pop. I want to pop something from the stack. So again, I call pip to return that first element, okay? So that I can inform the user that this element is the one that you pop out from the stack. And you call the remove first method from the DLL, okay? And then you return the object. And of course, if the stack is empty, you cannot pop, so you have to do the same thing. And finally, when you push, you just need to use the add first method inside the list, and then you are done. So do you need to consider overflow? in when you try to push, there's no such thing, because linked list, you can always add more elements to the front, okay? And unless you really use up all the memory in your computer, there shouldn't be a problem, right? So you do not need to worry about overflow if you are using linked list to do the implementation. So this is by composition, okay? What about inheritance? Inheritance means we actually create subclass out of the superclass, and then the subclass will use all the methods inside the superclass without creating an object. So again, this is the underlying data structure is actually the what they call the linked list, and in this case, LLE stands for linked list extension. Okay, so you extend. But the, of course, inside there have an S. So the you still have the top, which is actually pointing to the front of the list, but of course inside the linked list is pointed to by head, yeah? And then you have the number of nodes. Forgot to mention this. So all this, where's the push? The pop and the push. Do you need to, there's a number of nodes inside there, right? Do you need to do housekeeping here? Do you need to say number of nodes equal to minus minus and number of nodes plus plus when you push? No need, right? Because it is done inside the basic linked list. Okay? So don't do it down here. Then you actually subtract 2 times or you actually add 2 times. Right, so this is the implementation using linked list. So this is the stack linked list extension, extend, the S down here, basic linked list. Implement the stack interface, okay? To check whether the list is empty or the stack is empty, you just simply call the isEmpty method inherited from the superclass. Inside the basic linked list, you have this method, so you just use it. To pip, you just use the getFirstAdd method. Again, it's from the superclass, okay? And then you have to do the same thing down here. To pop, what do you do? You want to pop? Just remove first, yeah? Just simply say remove first. And then, of course, you want to pick first so that you can return that value to the user, yeah. Yeah, so you have to do the pip to get the value so that you can return. To push, just at first, yeah, very simple, okay? Of course, in this case, again, you do not need to worry about overflow, yeah? There's no such thing as overflow. Okay, so it's up to you whether you want to use composition or you want to use inheritance. Both way, very simple. Yeah, composition, you have to create object. Inheritance, you just use them, okay, without doing anything. Right, so the use of stack, you just run this and then you see that, okay, when you say push, first of all, you create the empty stack. So you have this empty stack, which is actually a string. And then you push all these things inside there, right? So if you first of all you check whether it's empty, so it will say empty. And then you push the 1, you push the 2. And then you print the top will be 2. You push the 3 and you push the 4. Right, then you pop 2 times, this 2 will be gone. And then the top of the stack is 2 again. Okay, so it's very simple. You should be able to do this. And then of course this kind of question can come out in the exam or we can just ask you to do some operation and then see what is the last, at the end, what is the content of the stack or something. Right, so in Java, there is also, as I said, we have this stack ADT. When you do this, you actually create empty stack. And then after that, you have all these operator inside that. Okay, it seems that there's a search method inside there. Which give us the impression that it's actually go through the thing, okay? But if you are implementing this yourself, you have to use another stack to help you, meaning that you have to pop and then put into the second stack and check whether it's the one that you are searching for and so on. At the end, you have to put it back, okay? So you have to use 2 stacks, quite similar to the one of the last year, past year midterm test where you use 2 basic linked lists to actually do the sorting. Okay, so you have to try to use this in the take-home lab and see whether you can, you know how to use them or not. Okay, so these are all the methods and so on. Right, so we want to look at some application of stack. The first one is what we call bracket matching, okay, to ensure that all the pairs of brackets are properly matched, okay, in terms of numbers, number of opening and number of closing, and in terms of type, okay, different type of brackets. Okay, so for example, is this a well-formed expression, meaning that in terms of the bracket that you have inside that? So in this case, these are okay, yeah? So these two match up, these two match up, these two match up, and then finally this match up. So this is a well-formed example. An incorrect example can have too many opening brackets, too many closing brackets. So you have only one open and then two close. Okay, so this is no good. This one is too many opening brackets, okay, two over here and one over there, no good. And this one is mismatched. So even though the two opening, two close, two closing, but they are not of the thing. Eh? So of course, when we look at this, okay, we are smiling at you. So how do you do it? Using a stack to check whether the expression is well-formed in terms of the bracket. So first of all, you create an empty stack, right? Something like this. And then for every character you read, you read in, you check whether it's an opening bracket, right? So if it is an opening bracket, you push it inside there, okay, you push. And then if it is a closing bracket, you pop one, and then you check whether the two are of the same type. If they are of the same type, you continue. If they are not of the same type, you straight away indicate that the expression is not matched, okay, not well-formed. And then at the end, you have to check. You have already used up all the character inside the expression. You have to check whether the stack is empty. If the stack is not empty, what does it indicate? Finish all the whole expression already, but the stack is not empty. Meaning that you have too many opening brackets, right? There's no closing bracket to match it. Okay, so that is the algorithm, very simple. Right, so for example, I have this. So you read the first character is an opening brace. So opening, you push, okay? And then you skip over all those until the next bracket. Opening, you push. You skip over all this, and another opening bracket, you push. And this one, you encounter a closing bracket. So you pop, waiting for me. And they match, so you pop it up, yeah? You continue. And you encounter another closing bracket. Again, you pop, and then you match them. Okay, no problem. You go down, another opening bracket, you push. And then closing, you match. And then another closing, and you match. So at the end of the expression, the stack is empty. So therefore, for this expression, the brackets are balanced. Okay, very simple. So you say, what type of error does the last nine test for? So we have already said, yeah? So this one is actually testing whether you have too many opening brackets. Yeah, too many opening brackets. Right, so the second application is what we call the trying to perform the aromatic expression, okay, evaluating the aromatic expression. Right, so we say that this is an expression, and these are the operands, A, B, C, D are operands. And then the operators equal, which is the assignment, plus, minus, multiply, divide, mode, okay, the remainder. Please, hopefully, if I set this question asking you to do addition, subtraction, and so on, in final exam, you know how to do it. If you still do not know, you want to go back to primary school to ask your teacher on how to do all these four operations. Multiply and divide has higher priority than minus and addition, right? You all know, huh? Worry. Okay, so you say that procedural precedent rules. Operators have priority over one another as indicated in the table, which can be found in most books. Okay, at the beginning of the lectures, I think we have one table that show you the priority. So if you are not sure, go back and visit it. Right, so you say multiply and divide has higher priority over plus and minus. And then for operators that have the same priority, you go from left to right. Yeah, so that is the associativity rules, right? Right, and then in terms of computer, beside the normal operation or expression that we have, we want to define these three things. In, pre, and postfix. Okay, infix, prefix, and postfix. What do you mean by that? When you say infix, you are talking about the operator. The operator is in between the two operands. We call this infix. If the operator is in front of the two operands, we call that the prefix before, pre. Eh? And then if the operator is behind the two operands, we say that this is postfix after. Okay? Right, so for example, this is an infix expression because the plus and the multiply are in between two operands. Yeah? Right, so the idea is we know if it is infix, there's a possibility of ambiguity. Right? And we have to use bracket to make it clear. Right? So in this case, of course, we know that using the precedent, this is actually equal to this guy. It's supposed to be this, okay? But to make it clear, you just use bracket to say that that operation has to be done first, right? So in this case, we say that if this is an infix expression, we can actually convert it to postfix by doing this, okay? So the first of all, you convert this expression to this postfix expression. And then after that, this whole expression will become this. So this is what we call postfix. And for this one, it becomes like that, okay? So the operator comes after those two dot operands that you are supposed to operate on. So you do this one, these two first, and then after that you do this. Okay? Right, so therefore, as we said already, infix is ambiguous. You need to use the rules to decide which operation to perform first. But in postfix, there's no ambiguity because every operator that you have, you should look for two operands in front of it. So these two belongs to this. And this become a new operand for this multiplication. Yeah? Right, so how do you calculate a postfix expression? How do you do the evaluation? You want to, given the postfix expression, you want to evaluate and return the final result, right? So again, you create empty stack, yeah? And for each item in the expression, like for example, this guy and so on, if it is an operand, you push. Okay, if it is an operand, you push. You push it onto the stack. If it is an operator, we say already, this operator should have two operands to operate on, right? So if that's the case, there must be two things inside there already. Otherwise, the expression is not well-formed. So anytime you encounter operator, you just push two items, and then operate on these two items, return the result back into the stack. Yeah, so that's what you say down here. So from this infix, we have already converted it to a postfix expression. Now we want to do the evaluation. So the first one is 2, so we push, yeah, according to the algorithm down here. By the way, this is what we call pseudocode. When we write algorithm, this is what we call pseudocode. Understand? Subsequently, especially from now on, this second half of the semester, most of the time we go for written tests, we ask you to actually give us algorithm. We are not asking you to implement methods anymore, unless some, like for example, recursive method you have to write. But most of the time, we will ask you to write or create algorithm. So you have to do it similarly like this. Right, so the second one is operand. So again, based on the algorithm, you actually push. The third one is an operand. Again, based on the algorithm, you push. Okay, now you encounter a plus, which is an operator. So you come to here. Right? You say pop 2 arguments, which is 3 and 4. You perform the operation because it's plus, so therefore add them together. You push the value, the result back onto the stack. And finally, you encounter another operator, multiply. So therefore, you pop 2 elements, perform the operation, push the result back. So therefore, you get 14. And then you will be at the end of the expression. The result will be the top of the stack. Yeah, so very simple. This is more complicated. We want to convert infix expression to postfix expression. Okay, how do we do it? So this one needs a little bit of, I don't know, whether you call it common sense or your knowledge about the operation, okay, the priority and so on. So first of all, I want to create this empty string to store the output. Okay, so this is actually the output, the postfix expression, given the infix expression, so given this, right? So you say that for each character that you encounter, so you read character by character, okay? For each character that you encounter, if it is an operand, what you do, you just output to the output expression, okay? Read from input, if it is an operand, you just output, okay? If it is an operator or bracket, then you have to consider what to do. So you say that if it is an opening bracket, what do you mean? What do you think is implying? So opening bracket is actually the starting point of a new sub-expression. Okay, a starting point. So subsequently, I'm going to say this many times. Okay, I said it just now. When you do stack operation, the algorithm always go this way. If the stack is empty, whatever you need to, the thing that have to go into the stack, you just push. Okay, if the stack is empty, you just push. Okay, unless the stack is not empty, then you have to, based on the first element on top, to make decision. When you see your opening bracket, you are actually saying that I have a new expression, so I can consider the stack to be empty. Okay, so I push the opening bracket inside that to indicate that this is a new expression, right? So therefore, opening, you just push. Okay? Now, of course, when you encounter a closing bracket, what does it mean? That means I'm at the end of one expression, a sub-expression. So I have already done all those things inside there. So therefore, I just need to pop up all those things until I encounter the opening bracket. Okay? So that is what it says. The first element is not the opening bracket. I just output whatever is on the stack to the postfix expression. Okay? And at the end, I pop away the opening bracket. So pop away the opening bracket to say that I have already finished converting this sub-expression into postfix. So this is not difficult. What happens if it is an operator? Remember that inside the stack is either opening bracket or operator, right? So if it is an opening bracket, you just push because it's a new stack, as I say, okay? But if the top is another operator, you need to decide whether this new operator should be pushed on top or the previous operator need to be popped away, depending on the precedent or the priority of these two operators, okay? So you say that while the stack is not empty, if the stack is empty, what do you do? You push, yeah, as we say already. And at the same time, the first element on top is not equal to the opening bracket. If it is opening bracket, what do? You push, because it's actually a new expression. You have an empty stack there, okay, when you have the thing. Otherwise, if this is not true, that means on top is an operator, it's an operator. So you have to decide. Okay, for example, if top is multiply, and now you have a divide, do you push or do you pop? On top is multiply. The new operator is divide. Do you pop away the multiply or you push the divide? Based on your understanding of the associativity rule. Because now these two operators are of same priority. Do you push or do you pop? You pop, right? Because you need to perform the multiplication first. You have to go out first. So therefore, you have to pop it first so that you can, when you evaluate the postfix expression, the multiply will be done first before the divide. Understand this? Okay? So therefore, if the next one coming in, you pop this guy before you push this guy. Of course, you have to pop all of them. Like for example, you cannot have two multiply inside there. So in this case, if they are of the same priority, you pop the one inside there and you push the second one inside. What about if I have a plus, and then the next one is multiplied? The top is a plus, and then the next one is multiplied. Which one, what do? You pop or you push? Meaning that I have 3 plus 4 multiplied by 5. So this one comes, I push already, and now I'm having this. Do you push or do you pop? Someone say pop. Of course you push. Because you need to do the multiplication first, right? You cannot pop the plus out, because once you pop the plus had to be performed first in the postfix expression. Okay? So therefore, in this case, you push. Okay? So that is what it says down here. It says that while the stack is not empty, and then the first element on top is not the opening bracket, which means it's not an empty stack, you check if the precedent of the character, which is the one coming in, is less than or equal to the one on top. If this guy coming in is less than or equal to the one on top, what do? You push, okay? Because you have to pop away the one on top inside there, because the one inside is having higher priority. Why not? If I have this situation, multiply and then the plus coming in, So this guy has lower priority than this guy. Of course, you have to pop this one first, because you have to perform that one first. You understand this? Yeah, so this is what it says down here. So if the character coming in is smaller than the operator coming in is smaller than the operator inside on top of the stack, you have to pop the operator. Yeah? And you continue until either it's empty or you don't have that. You don't have this condition. Okay? So you actually pop it out and then add it to the output. You pop this thing and add it to the output. And then after you finish all the possible value that are either higher or equal to the current operator, you push the new operator inside there. Can you understand this? Okay, logical, right? Very logical. Easier if we use an example to show you. Okay, and at the end, of course, you have to check. If the stack is still not empty, you have to output everything. You have to output all the operator inside there. Okay? So example, this is an expression that we want to convert from infix to postfix. Look at A, it's an operand. We say that if it's an operand, you output to the postfix expression. And then we have a minus. So at the moment, the stack is empty, right? When the stack is empty, you push. So now the stack has this. So the stack is actually, so this is actually the top. You go in this direction, yeah? The next one is opening bracket. Opening bracket indicate a new expression. You push it inside there so that this become a new stack, okay? Inside the stack. And when you have B, it's an operand, the algorithm say output to the expression, okay? Output to the expression. And then the next one is plus. At the moment, the top of the stack is opening bracket. It indicate the empty stack, yeah? So you just push. So you push the plus inside there. The next one is C, operands output. Okay, output to the expression. You have a multiply, okay? So now you have to make decision because the top of the stack is plus and the new operator coming is multiply, which has higher priority than the top of the stack. We say that if it has higher priority as compared to the top of the stack, you are supposed to push, okay? So you push this guy inside there. D is the operand you output. Now you encounter a closing bracket. So you are supposed to pop everything because now you finish the sub-expression already, you have to pop everything until the opening bracket. And then you pop away the opening bracket. So you pop, you get this, you throw away the opening bracket. Okay, and you finish the sub-expression. Right? So this guy now become like that. Yeah, B, C, D multiply. So indicate that I have to do this one first, C times D first. And then this become an operand for you to operate on the plus. Okay? Right, then you have the divide. So you have something on inside that which is minus. Minus is more lower priority than divide, so you have to push. Yeah, you push. And when you get this E, you just output. And when you are at the end of the expression, you just pop everything to the postfix expression. Okay? So therefore, this guy is actually converted to this guy. The prefix, the infix expression is converted to a postfix expression. Very simple. Any question? Right, so you say how to code these two algorithms. So you are supposed to complete this guy. I'm going to put this inside the software. Have I done it? I don't know. You can check the... If I haven't done it, I will do it after this lecture, yeah? And then how to convert infix to prefix. We have done the postfix one, but how do you convert from infix to prefix? This one is an exercise for you to try, yeah? All right, so before we take a break, I want to make a few announcements. This is important. Sigin Lab this Thursday, Sigin Lab 3. Topic is about linked list. Okay, we will give you the list node class and the extended linked list class inside the skeleton file. So you do not need to spend 10 minutes typing the thing inside there. And if you think that these two classes is easier for you to solve the problem, you use these two. Okay, so therefore you have the head, you have the add first, you have to remove first, you have to add after, you have to remove after. All these methods are inside there already. Okay, if you feel that these are good for you to solve the problem, then you use this. Okay, better control. You may choose to use the API linked list if you like, okay? Meaning that you are using index to control the movement. At the moment, you do not need to worry too much about efficiency. We say already, if you use index every time you start from the front, yeah, it's very slow, okay? This is important. I don't want to see any other data structures used inside this lab, okay? No other data structures, meaning that you should not use array list, you should not use vector, you should not use string, okay, even to store things, yeah? To string is okay because you want to print, but I don't think it is necessary, okay, for the lab. If you need to use to string, you use to string, okay? But should never use any other data structures to solve the problem, okay? Including not using array to read input. I do not know. For this group, I do not know whether there are still people using array to read the thing and then split. I don't understand why people do that, okay? Because scanner class already do that for you. You just use next and so on, right? You will split it for you. So I don't want to see anybody using array to do input, okay? Because I want you all to be able to do things differently. Do not need to always stick to one way to do it. You must learn how to do other things or to do the same thing in different way, okay? So if you use array to read input, you get zero for the whole lab. If you use array or any other data structures to solve the problem rather than using linked list, you get zero, okay? Because we want to make sure that you know how to use linked list, okay? Other than that, they are the same as per the other lab. There will be a midterm test for those 12 people who were absent. So 14 October, which is this Saturday, from 10 o'clock to 11:30. So we do not need to say 10:15, yeah, because I don't think there are other midterm tests on Saturday, right? This is, I think, seminar room 5, which is in COM 1201. Coverage, the same, okay? But as I said already, I cannot guarantee that the complexity or the difficulty level of the test is the same, okay? Of course, there won't be any more fraction. Those people who do not know how to add two fractions will be very happy that they are not going to do fraction. But it could be something else. It could be easier for certain people. It will be more difficult for some other people. I don't know, okay? Right, so if you have a valid reason for missing that test, you have to bring your document. Supporting document. If those of you who were taking accounting paper last Saturday, I have already received all the email from the lecturer, you do not need to do anything. But if your reason for absence is something else, you have to bring supporting document, MC, whatever, okay? Otherwise, you cannot do the test. Hey, wow. I didn't know I had this. Okay, I'm asked to show you this. I'm sure each one of you have already received an email, okay, from the university, right? About this? Yes or no? They told me that you have received an email, okay? Maybe you just think that they are what they call spam and then you delete it. Eh? No, don't go. Okay, so each one of you is supposed to go and take this course or these modules or this whatever you call it. You have been taken the direction from the Singapore Personal Data Protection Commission to roll out an e-training module. You are supposed to do these modules on NUS Data Protection Policy and Personal Data Protection Act guideline to students. So they are giving you some guideline about what you can do and what you cannot do. Okay, so each one of you has to do it before December 10. Okay, you are supposed to pass this test also. If you don't pass, you cannot graduate from NUS. I don't know, this is what I added in myself. You can do it as many times as you like. So there are only 5 MCQ modules. You know how to pass this test, right? Because you need to score 4 out of 5. So you can go and do all the possible combinations. Write a program and then just ask. Don't call me. It's recorded. No. Please read it carefully because you don't want to get yourself into trouble, okay? About 2 months ago, we received an email from this office and say that we actually allow a student to publicize Excel file an Excel file. And inside the Excel file, you have the student matrix number, you have the student telephone number, and so on. Because we were, someone was conducting a, I don't know what, workshop for some student. And then that guy was maybe the monitor or something like that, the coordinator helping to contact all those students. And then somehow he actually going to publish that file in some public domain. And some other people actually get hold of it and then complain. All right, so we don't want this kind of thing to happen. Okay, so there will be some guidelines that you are supposed to read and then to do, to practice when you are doing things, okay, related to personal data. So please read it and then make sure that you score 4 out of 5. I think it's better to score 5 out of 5. I don't think you should have problem. It's not fraction addition. Right? Okay, we take a break and then we come back and continue with the Q. I forgot. So previously you also have another tab. Thank you.
using a swap to do anything. You can just store the edge and just use a swap. So we can just bring in our own method to get it set, then we can just swap.
Okay, come back. Okay, settle down. Okay, so there are a few things that people ask. I think I will just answer it down here. Okay, first of all, the midterm test, I said there's no more tests this Saturday, but there is. So someone already have this problem. So we have to forget about the timing. It will be on Saturday. I have to go and book another room. And then I will make announcement. Most likely after 11:30. Maybe 11:30 until 1 o'clock. Okay, because her test is from 10 o'clock to 11:15. So we're going to give her 15 minutes break, right? Where is your test? Sudan? Where are you? Where? Science faculty. Huh? So we have it in the afternoon. What about one of these evening? Thursday evening, Wednesday evening? No. Sunday morning? I don't mind coming back. I mean, if it's convenient for everybody. Which you prefer? Saturday afternoon or... Then I'll have to set the question even more difficult. You have two more weeks to prepare, ma. Saturday afternoon? Actually, very bad for me. Or maybe early in the morning, 8 o'clock. Also can, Huh? Sure, huh? So those people who complain is because of you, not me, 8 o'clock, really? Okay, 8 o'clock, Saturday, 8 o'clock. After two, even worse. You know why? Because I have a family gathering at night and I have to go and do preparation, I have to do marketing and so on. morning. Saturday morning, 8 o'clock. Yours is 10 o'clock. Okay, not so early. Maybe 9 o'clock until 10:30. No, yours is what? Your test is 10 o'clock. Okay, so it has to be 8 o'clock. Okay, 8 o'clock. Right, someone says tech is useless. Because, as we say already, you can use basic linked list to add front, remove front. You can perform the push and pop. And in fact, if you look at linked list, they actually have all these operations inside there, push, pop, and so on. Okay, so why do we want to create a new ADT core stack? And subsequently, why do we want to create an ADT core queue? So the idea is, if I tell you I have a linked list, and then I want to use this linked list to do the stack operation, people cannot see the idea. If I tell you a stack, this is a stack, do you need to ask further questions? Okay, if I tell you stack ADT, you straight away know that you have a push and you have a pop operation. Yes or no? If I tell you a linked list or a basic linked list, you will have to figure out that add first is push and remove first is pop. It's not so clear. Can I understand? Whoever asked that question? Who say linked list the stack is useless? Yeah? If I tell you it is a stack, straight away you know that it's push and pop. You do not need to ask any further question. And the implementation is not too difficult, right? So that is the idea. Okay, when you see that this is a stack, you know that these are the operations that you can have. Okay. Restriction. So the idea is question is whether this Thursday Seeing Lab have any other restriction like what we have done inside the midterm paper. Right? For example, you are not supposed to take the value and do swapping. You are not supposed to move the nodes around. You have to create new nodes and all those kind of things. Okay, you can forget about all those restrictions. Okay? It's a problem that you are supposed to solve. Whatever the algorithm you are going to use, you can use it. Okay? No restriction except the use of other data structures. Don't use any other data structures. Okay? And then the question is whether we need to use generic for Thursday. The answer is no. Okay, you do not need to create generic linked list or generic. You just create linked list. Okay, because for this one, we know what data you are going to put inside there. So to make things less complicated, you can actually remove all the generic. If they give you the extended linked list that is generic, you can actually remove it. Okay, I will tell the lab PA later during the lab PA meeting. Okay, so you do not need to worry about what they call generic. Finally, I told you at the beginning that I'm going to give you an example of how you can improve the complexity using a stack, right? So there's this problem called monkey swing problem, which is one of the very famous question that we actually set. Monkey swing. Okay, you know that you know this guy called Tarzan, right? You know Tarzan? Tarzan? The guy, So this guy has a lot of monkey friends. And then you know monkey like to swing from one tree to the other, yeah? So one day, Tarzan had nothing to do. I gathered all the monkey friends and tell them, okay, so now we have this row of trees, okay? All lined up already like that. Okay, these are the three. Some taller, some shorter. So monkey say, all of you go and count how many possible swing that you can make from one tree to the other. So that, for example, there are N tree down here, right? So from here to here, you can make one swing. From here to here, you can make one swing, okay? The idea is the monkey cannot swing from one tree to the other if in between there's one more tree that is of equal height to one of those or taller. You understand this? So the idea is if these two are like that, this tree can go over there. So in this case, for this one, there are three possible swing. But if you have something like this, these two are of equal height, then you can have only two swing down here. Understand? Because you cannot make this swing. You will hit your forehead into the tree in the middle. Okay? Of course, like that cannot. You can only make these two swing. Understand this? So Tarzan say, okay, you all go and count. But then, of course, monkey cannot count. They cannot do fraction addition. So they come and talk to you and say, you are the best programmer. Can you please write a program to do this counting? So what is your algorithm? How do you count? So the brute force way is this. I take this one and see this tree can go to how many other trees. So in this case, it can go there. But after that, you still need to check whether this guy can go there or not. Have to check whether this guy can go there or not. Have to check this guy can go there or not. Okay? So this is, if you do this, it's already n squared, right? Checking whether one tree can go to the n minus one tree. Total will be n squared already. But at the same time, because if you want to check over this one, you need to see whether there's any tree in between that is actually taller or equal to these two trees, right? So therefore, this becomes n cubed, okay? Because each one of them have to check all these things inside there. So now the question is, how do I use a stack to help to reduce the complexity or the efficiency to O(n)? How do I do that? So let's take one example, yeah? So this is 8, 6, 5, 7, 8, maybe 5, 6, 5. Okay, so the idea is when you say O(n), it means that you only look at this value one time only. You only look at this value one time and then you solve the problem. So what do you think? How do you solve this problem using a stack? Right, so the algorithm goes this way, yeah? An empty stack, you look at this first element, we say always that if the stack is empty, what do? You push, right? So 8 go inside there. When the 6 come, do you push or do you pop? You make decision, because 6 is smaller than 8, do you push or do you pop? Why? Okay. The other principle that you want to remember is this. A stack is used to hold information. And if it is still useful, you keep it inside that. If it is no longer useful, you throw it away. Can you understand this? Okay, so the idea is, at the moment, this guy is still useful. Why? Because this is shorter, right? Smaller. So this guy can possibly go over it to the next 3 behind. So this 8 is still useful. Can you understand this? So therefore, you have to push. And when you push, you add 1. Because you can go from here to here. Right? Okay, now the 5 comes. Push or pop? Compare 5 with 6. You push, right? Because smaller again. 6 can go behind. Yeah? So you push. You add 1. When the 7 comes, what do? 5 is no longer useful. Because 5 you have already considered before, but 5 cannot go behind, right? So 5 is no longer useful, you pop. When you pop, you add 1. Because this guy can go, no. You have already added this, this guy can go there, right? What about 6? Do you push or pop? Pop, because 6 is no longer useful. 6 cannot go behind 7. Right, so you pop, you add 1. Right, because you have to consider this swing. What about 8? Do you push or pop? Because now on top is 8. 7 is smaller, you push. Or 7 go inside there, you add 1. Right, so this one, take care of this swing. Now the 8 comes. What do? Pop, because 7 is no longer useful. Yeah, you pop, you add 1. Because of this. Okay? What about 8 and 8? There's an 8 inside there. You push or pop. 8 cannot go over this 8, right? So effectively, you pop. Then you add 1. But now the stack is empty. What do? When stack is empty, push. So you push back the 8. So in fact, if you think about it, if you have equal, I do not need to push, I do not need to pop. I just add 1, okay, to take care of this swing. Did I add 1? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, okay, added already. Right, so I add inside there, the 5 comes, I push. I add 1. The 6 comes, I pop. I add 1, and then because this one is smaller, I push, I add 1, and then when the 5 comes, I push, I add 1, and I'm done. So do you look at the value more than one time? Each number, you look at it only one time. And so therefore, this is O(n). Understand this? Okay? And it improved from O(n) squared to O(n). So a stack can be used to do this kind of thing. Okay, so subsequently, you are going to see, maybe we have some example, take-home labs for you to practice similar kind of things. I can set this up as an exercise for you to practice on CodeCrunch. We have the setup. Okay, so go and practice. Right, the next data structures that we want to, or ATT that we want to do is Q. And this one is first in, first out. So Q is everywhere, okay? But of course, in real life, some of the Q are not first in, first out because people jump queue. We see it all the time in canteen. So if I see this kind of thing, I go forward and then pull that guy out. You are not supposed to jump queue, you know? Oh, I was here before. This is my friend. A lot of excuses. Just don't like this kind of people. Okay, so QADT is the operation that you can perform is actually enqueue and dequeue, right? So in this case, when you enqueue to the back. Dequeue, you dequeue from the front. So therefore, it's first in, first out. Yeah? That's why it's called first in, first out. And you can have pull, offer, and pick. Okay, so the enqueue, dequeue is the more easily understood words to use, right? But somehow in Java, they call it pull and offer. Pull is to put inside, okay? Offer is to take out. So this is actually enqueue, and this is actually dequeue. Okay? And then, pull is to Take out offer is to put into the queue. Sorry. Confused already. So this is the queue and this is NQ. Pip is to look at the first element. So if you think about it, the data structure is like that. Okay? Back of the queue and then front of the queue. To NQ, you offer it to the back. Offer to the queue, yeah? Poll is to take it out. Right? And then pip is to look at the first element. Okay? Right, so the use application, like for example, print queue. So the, you know, when you submit your job to the printer, there's a queue. So many people submitting. So which one come first? First come, first serve. Of course, sometimes they have the priority queue. Time something comes, it will jump queue, and then print the computer will print mine first. The dean comes, the computer will print the dean's job. Simulation. Okay, like for example, a lot of businesses, they want to know, they want to cut costs, but they don't want to make their customers suffer too much. So they do simulation, meaning that they actually get people to stand in front of the entrance and see, okay, how many people are coming in. They take the time, these people come in, and then the time the people left. Okay, so they want to see how many counter to open, how many service staff to station, so that, you know, they save cost, and at the same time, they are not going to make the customer too unhappy, right? So simulation, the queue. Subsequently, when you go to 2010, you are going to see what is this BFS, okay? How to traverse the thing in BFS, breakfast traverser. And then in this example, later you see, we are actually doing this palindrome checking. How do you use a queue and a stack to check whether the two value are palindrome, or the string is a palindrome. Right, so similar to stack, we can do it in two different ways. One is using array, and the other one is using linked list to do it. So again, we create an interface to specify the operation. So in this case, again, you have SMT, you have pip, you have poll, and you have the offer. Okay, and some of them, if the stack is empty, if the queue is empty, you cannot poll. If you are using array and the array is full, you cannot offer. So you have to throw exception. Right, so for a queue, if you create a new queue, you just do this. And then after that, you can offer, meaning that you put things inside there. And again, if this is using array, you just need to use the pointer, two pointer to help you to do it. Front is pointing to the first element. Back is pointing to the behind, which is actually empty. Right, so you offer again. So you can see that you actually put the value inside there, and then you move the back pointer one step behind. Offer. And then you pip, take the first element and put it there. You pull. And then put it there, offer, pull. So you can see, actually, you move the pointer, okay? So if you are using array to do this, you are not going to say, I keep the front inside here. Every time someone leave the queue, I advance them over there, like real life. In this case, you are just simply using the pointer to indicate that this is now the front of the queue. You are not moving the element to cover up the front of the array, yeah? Right, so implementation using array, you have two pointers, the front and the back, as we say. Front point to the first element, back point to the empty space behind. Okay, and then you can just put things inside there. Offer, pull, and so on. Okay, so the idea is that if you look at this, you know that eventually this guy is going to go behind, right? Bigger than the index of the array. So do you say that after this, I cannot offer anymore? I cannot enqueue anymore. But I have empty space in front because some of the things are already taken out, right? So in this case, we want to make this to become a circular array by saying that if you are here, you will just simply move it to point to the front. Make this a circular array and a circular queue, okay, by doing something like this. Yeah. Okay, so in order to advance from the back to the front, it's very simple. You just add one and then mark the maximum size. Right, so like for example, in this case, it's 10, right? So if I already 9, what I want to do is I add one and then mark 10. It will automatically go back to 0, right? Because if you are down here, add one become 10, 10 mark 10 is 0. So therefore, now the pointer will be pointing to the front, right? So circular, yeah? Now, then you have this problem. What happens if you have front equal to back? Is it empty queue, full queue, or what? Right, so let's say we have only something like this, yeah? So this is the front. At the beginning, the empty, yeah, back is also pointing here. So this one indicate empty, right? So I offer something, back go to here. I offer something, back go to here. I offer something, back to go to here. I offer something, because circular, back also come to here. So now it's a full queue. So how do you decide when you have front equal to back, it is an empty queue or it is a full queue? How do you decide? So you say full queue, empty queue, both A and B. Of course, this one is no good. So answer is this guy. But computer science, you cannot do something like that, right? You have to decide, you have to make decision. So of course, the easier thing to do is you use the number of nodes or whether the queue is empty. Yeah, you can use the to check. But every time you do that, you have to check. So sometimes people feel that this is not a good solution, right? So this is what we say just now. When the two together, it can be empty, or when the two together, it can be actually full. So there are two ways to do it. One is you use this guy to say that it's empty, and you use this guy to say that it is full. Okay. Otherwise, the second solution is you sacrifice one space. Right. So in this case, if this is the case, you say that you have a full queue. Back is already pointing to an empty space that is next to that thing. Then you say that it is a full queue, meaning that B plus one mode, the maximum sign is actually equal to F. If that is the case, we say that it is a full queue. Okay, so you actually wasted one space to help you to make this decision. Right, so the implementation, queue using array to implement the queue interface. So again, first of all, you create the array, indicate that this is of this type. Front and back, the two indices, maximum size, and then the initial size, similar to what we have in stack. So first of all, the constructor. Okay, you create this empty array, and then you put both of them pointing to the same place. So in this case, front and back are the same. This is empty, yeah? Initial size. To check whether it's empty, we have already made this decision. When they point to at the same place, they are empty. So it could be in the zero, it could be anywhere along the array. Right, so to check whether it's empty, you just, if it is empty, you return now. Okay, that means nothing inside there. Of course, you can also throw exceptions if you like. Otherwise, you send back the first element. Okay, the element pointed to by front. To pull is means to take it out. Okay, from there, this is DQ. It's empty, you return now. That means you don't get anything. Otherwise, you store the thing inside there. And what you need to do is this is not necessary if you don't want, yeah? But you want to put it physically, make it, and after that you just move your pointer to the next value. And the idea is if you move outside the array, you have to bring it back to the front, okay, by using this mode operator. This is to offer and queue to the queue. So the idea is if this is the case, you have a full queue, right? Just now we said already. If back plus one mode is equal to front, you have a full queue. So if you have a full queue, you cannot add one more. You cannot add one more, and then you have to do is to enlarge. You have to call the enlarge method similar to the stack to enlarge it. And then after that, you can put it back there. So now the question is, how do you do enlarge? Is it the same as the stack where you do something like this, and then just copy like that, and then point this pointer instead of here, point it to here. Is this the way to do it for queue? If you do it this way, then you destroy the queue, right? So in this case, you cannot do it. The idea is, you know, you might have a back down here, and then front down here. Yeah, these are all occupied. Okay, so if you just simply create this longer, back is down here, and there's another element. If you just copy like that, what happened? This guy go here, this guy go there, this guy go there, and then there's empty space, and then this guy go there, and this guy go there. And then after that, you say, okay, point this pointer to here. Is this work? Does this work? No, right? It will not work, because now your back is down here, and your front is down here. But there are some empty space down here, there's some empty space down here. So you cannot do it this way. So in this case, it's more troublesome. Okay, so what you have to do is, you have to check where is the front, and then where's the back? Back is here. And you have to start doing this by pointing this to here, pointing this to here, pointing this to here, or moving this to here, and so on. So you are supposed to create the queue, start such that the first element is in front, and then fill up the rest of the elements. Can you understand this? Yeah? Okay? So this enlarge is actually, first of all, create a new array, and then if the X is actually empty, you define false. Why? How can you have this? How can you have this? I create a new, I want to create a new array, and then X is equal to null. What does it mean? Anyone? We know that if you do this, you are supposed to get a contiguous memory space from the system, from the computer. But at the moment, all your memory are fragmented, and the computer cannot return an area big enough for this array. It will return null here. Can you understand this? So this is a runtime exception because you don't have enough memory which is contiguous. Okay. So if this is the case, you have to return false. Otherwise, you have already created the thing, and what you do is actually you do the thing that I say. Okay. Starting from the front, and then after that you copy this. So this is the statement to do it. Okay. And then at the end, since you have done that, front will be in front. So front becomes zero, and back become the maximum minus one, because you have so many elements inside there. And then after that, you just point the pointer. Instead of pointing to here, you point to here. Okay, and then you set the maximum size to become the new size. Okay, so this is enlarging the queue, different from what you have done for your stack. Right, so the queue has that problem. We don't want to do that, and we will have to do implementation using linked list. Okay, so again, we can do either composition or you can do inheritance. Right, composition is create a object and then use the linked list method for you to do it. So in this case, we know that if you want to implement a queue, definitely you don't want to use a basic linked list. Right, BLL is no good for queue because when you want to enqueue, you are supposed to enqueue to the back. So therefore, you should use a TLL, the tail linked list. Right? So therefore, you use a tail linked list. So again, you encapsulate this into a queue. Right. So QLL implementation, implement this ADT, this interface, and you use the, because it's composition, so therefore you create a linked list, tail linked list object. Okay? And the check is empty, you just you call the method inside the linked list, it's empty. Offer, you just add last. Tail linked list has this method for you to add last. So you just enqueue to the back. Pip is to return the first element, right? Pointed to by the first pointer. Poll is to remove, yeah, remove first. Right, so if it's not empty, you remove. If it's empty, you have to, what you call, throw an exception, yeah? The other one is by inheritance. So create a subclass. Yeah. So you create a subclass by extend the tail linked list, implement the thing. Okay. So again, if this is what they call inheritance, you just simply write the method inside the superclass. Okay. So to offer is to what? Offer to the linked list, right? So it's actually adding. Yeah. So you just add last. Just call add last and put the things inside there. Pip, return first, return the first element. Poll, remove first. Okay, so you should be able to do this. And this is, you have already the queue, so now you want to test it. So again, you can run this and see how the thing works. Right? Anna. In Java, there's an interface queue. So you cannot just simply say queue equal to new queue. There's no queue inside the Java class. And in fact, this interface is actually implemented by some other data structures like linked list and so on. They actually have this pip, poll, and remove method inside those classes. You can go and take a look. Yeah. Right, so one possible application, if you want to check whether a word is actually a palindrome. Okay, what is palindrome? It means that you read this man in this direction and you read the other direction, both are the same. Okay? So this is a palindrome, this is a palindrome, this is a palindrome, and these are not. Okay? So how do you do it? The algorithm goes this way. So first of all, I get character by character. So you can character at zero and then you use the index to find, right? So given a string, What you want to do is you use a stack to reverse the order. We know that stack is last in, first out. So if that's the case, if you do that, you are reversing the string. And then you use a queue to preserve the order, first in, first out. Yeah. So therefore, in the stack you have this, and in the queue you have this. You put them inside there first. And then after that, what you do, you remove pair by pair. I mean, two characters at one go. So if they are all equal, then it is a palindrome. Yeah, very simple. Right, so this is just a program to actually do for you to check whether a string is actually a palindrome. Okay, so you can try this out yourself. Summary, we learn to create our own data structures from array and linked list. So subsequently, when you go to 2010, they are going to tell you that in Java or in most of the programming languages, we have this thing called the basic building block. Right? You use this basic building block to create additional, more complex data and program. Right? So array, linked list, and subsequently tree, they are all what we call basic building block. Yeah? And for these two, they are last in and first out. And also, we say that drawing can help you to understand the cases. Okay? So you say you don't want to forget them. They are actually provided inside that. You do not need to create your own. But you need to know which one to use. Okay?